Good afternoon, everyone. Delighted to see you here. As I hope you've noticed at MIPCON this year, we've paid a lot of attention to issues of diversity and inclusion. Now, that focus is continuing today with our latest screening of Informa. Informa debuted just last night on BBC One, creating a huge buzz on social media. Please feel free to keep tweeting from here today. It was produced by Neil Street Productions, an All3 Media company, for the BBC and Amazon Prime Video in the US. Informa is a flagship BBC One drama, doesn't shy away from any of the issues of inclusion and diversity, which is a really welcome sign of the times today. Now, there's a lot to discuss about this show, so the best ones to do it will be our guests today. Rachel Glaister, who is the EVP of International Brands for All3 Media International. Sunetra Sarkar, who plays Sadia Shah on Informa. And Nick Brown, who's the executive producer of the show for Neil Street Productions. Let's give them a warm welcome.
Hello, and firstly, thank you very much for joining us today. We've only got a very short amount of time, so you'll be getting to watch a pretty amazing show very, very soon. So I'd just like to say that in some ways, All3 and Neil Street feel that while we're really happy to support any diversity strand, we feel slightly like the interloper because you're a mainstream producer, as you've made Penny Dreadful, you've made Call the Midwife. We made this as a mainstream show for the BBC and Amazon, but it is rather special. So could you take us into that process?
Yeah, no, it's lovely to be here. Great to be part of this diversity program. But as Rachel said, we went out on BBC One last night, so on the biggest, most mainstream channel in the UK. We didn't set out for this to be a diversity story. We set out to tell a great story. And work with writers whose talent we admired and loved. And that's really where we started. So that, I think, is the most important thing. Is we try to remain open to stories from wherever, by whomever, and follow that. And that has led us to Informa, which, as I hope you'll see, is... reflects how London is today, how the world is today, and is also specifically set in the world of the war on terror. But hopefully you'll agree that it's approached in a way that feels different from other shows that have done that. It comes at it through a family, and it's really about the people on the ground who are out there every day trying to find ways to protect us all and stop bad things happening. And the consequences for them and the price that they pay for doing that work.
Can you go back to the very beginning? I believe this started with one of your colleagues being approached by a writing partnership.
Yeah, we were simply sent a spec script by two writers, Sohrab Noshirvani and Rory Haynes. Rory is British, Sohrab is Iranian-American. They'd met at Columbia Film School about 10 years ago. They were based in LA, and they were doing what lots of writers in LA are doing, which is just writing spec scripts and trying to get stuff off the ground. They'd not had anything made. We got a spec script via their manager, which we loved. We loved their writing, we met them, and we wanted to know what story they wanted to tell. And for a long time, they'd been interested in the relationship between an informant and his handler, and felt that that story hadn't been told on screen before. So that was the kernel of the idea. They wanted to set it in East London, and from that grew this show.
And the lead, well, you have several leads, but the young lead is this man here on the left, and he was quite new to television, first role.
He's brand new to television, yeah. So along with brand new writers, we ended up casting Naban Rizwan to play Raza, the lead. It's his first screen role. He is extraordinary and charismatic and luminous. And I think nobody would imagine it's the first time he's been on screen. So we were very, very lucky. The show, a lot of the show, and the heart of the show is him, and we were extremely fortunate to find him.
And did that present difficulties? Obviously, you've got very experienced actors in the show, like Sinetra here, but did you have to fight his cause? Because he really does carry. He's in a lot of scenes for a big primetime drama.
Yeah, I mean, the casting process was really interesting because, again, as you'll see, in fact, it's 96 speaking parts across the series, and it's a big range of characters. To be honest, when we were looking to cast a young South Asian actor, there were not that many who are, in fact, there's hardly anybody who's really well known. There's a few who've done some small things. Obviously, there's a couple of older actors, British actors, who are really well known. You know, obviously Riz Ahmed and Dev Patel. But other than that, you know, there are very few. And that was part of the excitement, really, was finding this new talent and having a cast to discover and find who were from all sorts of different backgrounds. And as I said, I think it reflects the world that we live in. It certainly reflects London and how it currently is. And it was a really exciting process to go further and wider than perhaps other shows had done before, and find people who we didn't recognize or hadn't come across before. And there's this incredible wealth of talent out there, and that was one of the most thrilling things about it.
When we first encounter you in this show, you appear to be Naban's mother.
Yes.
And for those who don't know, Sinetra is a very, very familiar face on British television, and she doesn't look it, but apparently she has been on screen for 30 years. Should we go back to the beginning of the 30 first?
We can do that. I've been very fortunate to be able to be an Asian actress in UK TV. There weren't many people that looked like me on television when I started in 1988, and I was actually the first teenager of Asian origin who was British that I saw on television. So I became my own role model, I think, which was very difficult growing up in Liverpool in 1988, because you did want to find someone to relate to. And I think television is one of our first points of call to be able to, you know, choose what you'll wear, how you'll speak, what you want to do. And if you don't address everybody in the country, you can start feeling quite lonely. And so I felt like through my career, I started to become a lot of people that didn't get themselves shown on screen. However, that also meant I had to choose roles that were not specifically about being Indian or Asian. So I had to play a lot of characters that were called Claire, Zoe, Ange, you know, not Sangeetas and Sadias. A character like Sadia didn't exist when I started my career.
What do you actually mean by that? The representation of it, or?
Not just the representation of it, but the three-dimensional aspect of a character. You would never explore a story and make the Asian woman a central character. It just didn't exist. It still doesn't exist in some territories, and I really feel that Britain has stepped forward and tried to address this issue. However, unless you have the writers that are writing the three-dimensional characters, you can't bring them to life. So I didn't have the opportunities to play characters like the one I'm playing now. So it's only in my later years that I'm actually addressing my heritage and my cultural isms. And being a second generation, I don't sound Indian particularly. I may not look traditionally Indian, but there are many, many women who look like me on the streets of England. So to find a script that is addressing that and is telling a great story within it was rare. And so for me, I jumped at the opportunity to play a woman who had, she's sassy, she's cool, she's funny, she's grounded, she has a career, she's a very normal person. She happens to be Pakistani and she happens to be a Muslim, and she happens to also not have the legal documents to live in the country, which again does cover a market of the audience that watch television now. So I think it's really brave to be able to make a television program like this. It will be a first, so it may take another few years before everybody makes programs that have a multicultural essence like Informa has. Like Nick said, 96 people in a whole, as a big cast, and a lot of those 96 voices are from different backgrounds, different nationalities, different communities. We may all speak English, but we speak it in our own way. And I think it's nice to open the door and let you see inside the houses of homes that you haven't been able to see before. Especially, like I say, back in 1988, you never saw programs like this, except those people did still exist. And so for me, the story was the first point of jumping up and down, that there was a story being told that was exciting. I couldn't tell what was going to happen. Every page I turned, I couldn't work out what was going to happen next. So that was a really big pull. But also the fact that I hadn't seen a female Asian written quite as well as this before.
You mentioned when we were speaking earlier about how the families are portrayed and how by default an Asian or particularly an Indian family and the extension of that family and how they live together.
Mm-hmm.
You had not seen that, and you thought the writers had got that very
on
point.
And I think this is what is so interesting. We are allowed to assume a lot more than we used to. We don't have to spell it out to everybody. There are many different forms of a modern family now, and that's not just for your average British family, that is for your average second generation Pakistani family as well. In this story, we will discover that Sadia is not actually the biological mother of Raza and his brother. She has actually become their mother through default. Their mother passed away, she died, and this woman, who is a friend of the family, has stepped in and brought them up as her own with their father. Not romantically, just as some families work. This is how a lot of cultures do embrace family, friends, extended family, becoming the core family. Especially, I come from an immigrant family. My parents moved to the UK in 1972. They didn't have any family in the UK, so their friends became their family. And I call a lot of people uncle and auntie that are not really my uncle and auntie. And we reflect things like this in Informa, because that's true. And the authenticity is what I feel this show brings to the table that not a lot of shows do.
Brilliant. We'd be remiss not to mention some of the other cast members. Obviously, we've got Paddy Considine. Do you want to talk to us about those briefly?
Paddy, it's one of those times where, as a producer, you read a script and you think about the person you'd most like to play this part, and then they end up playing it. So it sort of was a dream scenario, really. Paddy, who doesn't do a huge amount of television, is a wonderful, wonderful, very rooted, real actor. Plays Gabe, who's the counter-terrorism officer who recruits Raza. And as I said, really the heart of the show is that relationship and how that relationship shifts over time. And the way in which they come to understand each other, because both of them are living a double life. Both of them are having to spin a web of lies and deceit around them and with their loved ones and with their families in order to just survive and do their job. And then Belle Powley, who plays Holly, who is Gabe's new young partner. So Belle, again, the exciting thing is she hasn't done British TV for a little while. She's had a career in the States. She's a wonderful, terrific actress, incredibly memorable, amazing face. And she's an interesting character because she is a millennial. She's somebody who is also insanely curious. And it's her curiosity which makes her very, very good at her job, but it also becomes something that is a threat to Gabe because she starts to notice things about his life and things that are going on that don't seem quite right and begins to poke around in them. So Gabe's carefully constructed life that he's trying to manage also begins to fall apart. So there's a kind of duality about what Raza is doing and what Gabe is doing, and Holly is in the middle of it all. So those are the, you know, and around that we have, you know, wonderful actors like Sinetra and Stanley Townsend and Sharon D. Clarke and Jessica Raine. And as I said, then around them, a whole circle of newer faces who it was wonderful to work with and just great to see on screen.
And you said, was it 96 or 97?
96.
Yeah. Which director was corralling the 96?
Yeah, so Johnny Campbell directed all six episodes. I hope you'll agree, I think he's done a wonderful, wonderful job. We didn't initially think we would have one director because it was, it's 6 hours, and we thought we might not be able to make that work, but he came in very, very passionate about the writing and really wanted to tell the whole story from beginning to end. So he's done a wonderful job. I think London looks great. It's a London that's not often seen on screen. We shot it towards the east end of London, which is a really interesting area of both of sort of poverty and wealth rubbing up against each other side by side. It's the old docks area, which is always the most fascinating parts of cities where people have constantly come and go and laid down roots over the years, different from different countries, big, you know, obviously a big immigrant portal for the city. But it's beautiful. It is, you know, it's some tough areas and it's not traditional London. But we wanted to make it look lovely, and we wanted to reflect the warmth of people who live there. And that, I think the other thing about the show that that you'll find and surprises people is that it's funny. It has a warmth and a wit about it that when we say it's a story about counterterrorism and it's a thriller, people don't expect that. And I think there's something that the writers have always said, which is so important about how we approached making this show, is that they always said, the thing to understand is that none of the characters, they don't know they're in a thriller. So they don't play the part as if they're in a thriller. You know, they don't deliver the lines like that, and they're not serious in that way. They're just people who are getting on with stuff and get caught up in something bigger. So I think that was a way that we approached it that I hope has made it feel very rooted and grounded and warm and funny.
Brilliant. It is warm, it is tough, it is beautiful, and I have to tell you, I've only seen a few episodes, but it is brilliant. We're going to let you watch episode one now. Contrary to other environments, we'd love you, should you be able to get a signal, to tweet and do whatever you like while you're watching it and spread the word about it. So thank you very much for coming. Thank you both.
Thank you.
Very, very
thank
much. You. And we'll let you watch it now.